Good evening, everyone. I have a really special show tonight. Some interesting things that we're going to cover on tonight's show. Some good dog training things, life lesson things. And I'm going to announce, towards the end of the show, I'm going to announce some later evening Periscopes that I'm going to do. I'm going to do some Periscopes after the show, actually. One or two more Periscopes. And I'll talk about those a little bit later. Someone can just remind me, probably around, 45 minutes into the show, to talk about that. But first, this is Linda.
Hello, everybody.
And I'm Jeff. Hey, guys. All right, let me just adjust my camera. Adjust my camera here. Adjust my iPad here, I should say. All right, let's get this thing in. There we go. Linda and I get to get nice and cozy with each other. Hello, everybody. Again, this is Jeff Gellman of Sally Canine Training. And we're going to do the What Would Jeff Do show. And what we do is every Monday and Wednesday night, we do a Q&A. Linda asks the questions. I answer the questions. I'm actually the dog trainer in the group here. Linda's my awesome sidekick for my shows. It's a great time for folks to, let me just turn on my chatterbox. There we go. It's a really great time for folks to ask your dog training questions. And the reason is because every day I get, dozens of, thanks, Jeff, dozens of questions and I can't answer them. So I've got a lot of free ways to do,
you can get a hold of
me, and that's usually through my 20 hours of Periscope a week. I also offer Skype sessions, and then I also offer
Mama Hans, your home.
Talk training, our training facility. So let's keep that in mind. Don't forget, you also can share this on the replays. That's something people might not know, is on the replays, you can share this on your Android, you can go up and down, and on your iOS, you go, side to side. And right now you can share the show and invite people. Thank you, Jordan, for inviting people. Thank you, Raquel, thank you for inviting people. That's so nice. Little character in the corner, click on the character, and you can actually share this and invite people on Twitter, on Periscope, and on Facebook. Also, at any time you want, you can take a screenshot of us. If you tweet me a screenshot, I will actually send you a video, a personalized video, and you'll probably get that in the next 48 hours. And so you can always take a screenshot of us at any point you want. And I just want to remind everybody, on the replays, you can give us hearts on the replays as well. And the way you give hearts is you can click on the screen, tap on the screen. Also remember, they max you out at 500 hearts here. So what a lot of people have been doing is they've been actually logging off and then logging back on really quick. You don't have to do that, but a lot of people are doing that. So let's get right into the questions. And we will hit everybody's question tonight. But keep in mind, we do get a lot of questions. Also, that a lot of this stuff is rapid fire. It's rapid fire. So sometimes you don't get a full synopsis on how to fix the problem, but you get sort of a ballpark estimate. And then also what I'm going to start doing is pulling questions out of these shows and then expounding or expanding on them one at a time during the course of the week. Or maybe I'll even do that after the show, who knows, but not tonight, because I've got a couple of other shows lined up for this evening, and I'll announce those later in the day. So if someone could remind me tonight, about 45 minutes into the show, to remind everybody what
you're
those
doing more tonight.
I'm gonna do more tonight.
What about me?
You can do so. I'll go in the other room. I'll go in the other room. We'll do dueling Periscopes, but I'll go in the other room. It's all about the replays anyway. Don't worry about it. They can catch it later. So I want to thank everybody from Norfolk, Virginia. I had a great seminar in Norfolk, Virginia. Tonight, I'll probably put up about 50 photos on the event page from Norfolk, and I've got about 200 photos I'll probably end up putting up. So I'll be putting up a lot of content on the Norfolk, Virginia. We're heading down to Ellenton, Bradenton, Florida, and we actually have some working spots as well as audit spots available this weekend, and you can go to rvdogtrainer.com, and you can actually see my touring schedule. All right. So any questions yet?
Nope.
No questions. Okay. So we've got some great dates. We've just announced another date up in Canada. I'm in the Toronto area. And we also are going to be announcing another Australian one in Cairns as well. Your 11-week-old puppy craps in a crate every day. We're gone. So 8 hours a day is too long to have your dog in the crate. So 8 hours a day is too long to have your 11-week-old dog in the crate. So unfortunately, you're going to have to split that in half. So you're maxing out at about 4 hours for an 11-week-old puppy. And you're going to have to find someone to either come over the house halfway through. But you're going to really, really struggle with a 11-week-old puppy to be successful, crate training that dog at such a young age. All right, such a young age. All right. Having problems with the German Shepherd healing. He's being very pushy using remote collar to pinch. So what I want you to do is I want you to do a couple of techniques. I've got videos on remote collar healing. I also have a video on my 180. I want a video on my on the 180. So there's that 180 move that I do. But remote collar healing, if you're doing remote collar healing properly, you will be able to actually get your dog to walk actually behind you, almost in follow mode. And you want to be able to do that with a remote collar. My colleague Sean O'Shea makes a really, really good video on that. How long is it taking a dog to be kept in a crate? I mean, a dog can be kept in a crate a lot, but you want to break it up. Also, it depends on what you're doing in between crate time. In between crate time, puppies, believe it or not, spend 8 to 20 hours in a crate, but it's broken up. They need time to go out to the bathroom. They need some play time. They need some structure. They need some training time, and they need to be outside on different surfaces because you're doing a lot of the socialization and the imprinting right now. But 8 hours in a row is really rough. Now, everything I do, all my social media is solid canine training. Just go on Instagram and just search for me. You can also go onto my website, Solid Canine Training. Solid Canine Training. And a lot of the links are right up at the top. As far as anxiety in the car, what I would do is anxiety in the car is I would crate the dog in the car, put the dog into a down, and then do short trips, right? Short trips. You can actually start also doing training in the car, like go in the car, kettle up in the car, down in the car without the car even moving, coming back out. So turn going in and out of the car, a obedience command. And then also, what I want you to do is I want you to be able to go on shorter trips right now. All right. Your bulldog mastiff fosters growling at your daughter occasionally. It all depends on, well, how old is your daughter? All right. How old is your daughter? And when is the dog growling? How long should a training session last? Depends on what you're doing. Depends on the age of the dog. Okay. Age of the dog. All right. Your daughter's 14 years old. So, you know, is your daughter putting too much pressure on the dog? If the daughter's putting too much pressure, like is your daughter getting in the dog's face?
Howdy, Lee. I'll get to you.
Is your dog getting in the dog's face? Is your dog hugging? Is your child hugging the dog? Is your child doing a lot of different? There's so many different variables about why a dog would growl. It has to be. I need a little bit more context in that. All right. If the dog's not in training mode. What I would do is if you're training the dog. If you're doing remote collar training, I suggest putting the remote collar on in the morning, taking it off at night. Make sure you switch sides every 4 hours. You don't want to just put the collar on. You don't want to just put the collar on when you're doing, like obedience work. All right. Spaying or neutering can change its behavior. I guess it can, but not spaying and neutering can also change the dog's behavior at all. I'm a huge advocate of spay and neuter, just for, unless you're going to be breeding your dogs, and if you are a breeder and the dogs come from a really good, genetic makeup on those dogs. Dog chases and stares at shadows and lights. Make sure you're not using a laser pen on the dog. Chances are the dog might have been trained with a laser pen, which is probably the worst thing for a dog to do. It's, gets the dog too excited. It actually creates an OCD behavior in the dog. So as far as, doing, shadows and lights, what I would do is I would break all that stuff up. I would break, interrupt that behavior. Teach that dog how to be a little bit more calmer by doing duration work with like place and down. All right. So how young is too young for a prong collar and why? 14-week-old lab pulling like crazy. You can absolutely use a prong collar on a 14-week-old lab. More puppy training videos. Right now I don't have access to puppy. I don't have access to puppies, so I can't do a lot of puppy training videos, but I'm sure on YouTube there is a ton of them. All my puppy training videos are food-based, so anybody that's doing some really, really great puppy, balanced puppy stuff, but a lot of our puppy stuff is, you know, quote unquote, all, you know, food motivated one. All right.
So Bulldog Mastiff Joe is 3 years old. Sometimes he growls by my side and sometimes just by himself.
All right. So what I would do is if your dog is growling by himself, meaning just out of the random growling, I would check for any health issues. I would check for any pain or discomfort. Bulldog Mastiff is a larger breed dog. There could be, you know, any kind of bone or muscle issues going on. Check the teeth, check the ears, check the spine, see if there's any arthritis. The dog might have hip issues. So the dog's growling at your daughter. If it is purely behavioral, what I would do is you would correct the dog, but also someone mentioned about petting. Some dogs don't want to be pet. All right. Some dogs don't want to be petted. So I would be super careful about the amount of pressure. I would document all the times when your dog is growling. It could be a behavioral issue, but also he jumps in her laps. Okay, well, that's also dominant. So chances are your dog is just being a pushy, snotty dog. I personally wouldn't let the dog jump in someone's lap without permission. All right. Without permission. All right. So I'm not just a fan of prong collars. I actually don't have a problem with a lot of training tools. I'm a huge fan of training. Martingale collars are very hard to train a dog on. Martingale collars actually cause way more discomfort and pressure on a dog's neck than a prong collar ever will. Prong collars are probably one of the more gentlest tools out there. They were absolutely designed to create no harm on the dog's neck at all. Where a martingale actually, once it's fully engaged, actually can actually choke the dog. So I actually can choke a dog out with a martingale, where a prong collar would be very, very challenging, you know, to do that.
All right. I have a lot of questions.
Okay, go ahead.
Dog came home from a board and train and now is being aggressive with other dogs in the house.
So,
and the dog wasn't like that before.
All right. So what I would do is I would actually talk to the, I have no idea why that's happening. That is something you'd want to bring up with the person that the dog went to the board and train with. That would be another with a board and train with. It can be many, many, many variables. What I would do is also, if you've got other dogs in the house, you'd also want to check in on your structure. So that would probably have, you know, 20 different variables. It could be the home environment, the lack of structure in the house on all the dogs, not just this dog. I don't know. There could have been an incident at the board and train. What I would do is I would call your trainer up. You reached out to the trainer and you never heard back. I would reach out again. I would reach out again, and what I would do is try to figure it out. That's something I would need way more information on. Anytime there's any aggressive type stuff on a Periscope, it's really hard to pinpoint it because this is way too fast. But that's the suggestion that I would make. All right, he's structured there or not. What I would do is I would actually make sure they are structured as well. So whenever you've got a multi-dog household, you want to have everybody on the same thing. All right, thanks. Okay. You have a Great Dane who eats off the counter. That's really dangerous for a Great Dane as well as any dog. Your dog could actually die. So let's just be really clear about that. Your dog could die from eating something off the counter. So what we want to do is, I've got a very, very easy protocol for getting dogs to not take food off the counter. And what I do is, what I do is I would correct the dog at a very high level on a remote collar. And what you do is the remote collar should be on the dog, and you have food up on the table, and you actually leave the room, or up on the counter, and you actually leave the room, and you actually look. And then what you do is you look through a window, or you set up a video camera that's on real time. And if the dog goes to wait till the dog actually makes contact with it, I would correct that dog at the highest level. And yes, you are actually administering lots of discomfort to the dog. And the reason why you're doing that, and the reason why you're doing it usually once for up to 3 seconds, and it's a high level, your dog actually could die if you don't stop this and just talk to any vets. I'm a big fan of e-collar technologies. You can go to our website at solidcaninetraining.com, and you can go to our little shop, and you can see the remote collars that we carry. Remote collars. Weimaraners, are they hard to train? We don't think so. A lot of the Weimaraners that we see personally are extremely nervous. we see a lot of very nervous, fearful, skittish Weimaraners. That doesn't mean that they all are, or that's an indication of the breed. That's what we see. As far as the difficulty to train, they train up just like any other dog does, like any other dog does. All right, what else?
First e-collar command to teach an older dog with previously poorly reinforced obedience commands.
So what I would do is, with remote collar training, teach place first. Teach place. That's a really good command to start out with is place. If you're just tuning in, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I'm a real dog trainer. I own a dog training business in Providence, Rhode Island. It is called Solid Canine Training. If any of my fans want to just put the website up there, they can. I actually travel the world, though, doing seminars. I've got an awesome staff of 9 people who run that training center, like something incredible. I specialize in aggression rehab and heavy behavior modification, but I also can, thank you so much, Piotto. I also work with young puppies and every single dog, but my specialty is aggression rehab. There's a little character in the corner. Click on the character. You can share this on Facebook, share this on Twitter, share it on Periscope. And you're probably going to want to like me and follow me on Periscope. And then also, you're going to want to turn on your alerts so you get notified of these. I'll be doing 2 more Periscopes tonight, and I'll announce what those Periscopes are afterwards, towards the end of the show. All right. In your experience, what breed has been the fastest learners? That's a hard one. I mean, I think you can answer that one in a little bit. Once you find the motivation of the dog, I think all dogs can be relatively simple to train. I'm a balanced dog trainer. I break down training really simple as just yes and no, and then finding the motivation to do yes and no. All right. I don't recommend correcting high before you condition the dog to the e-collar. That's not to say you cannot do it. I like the dog to have some conditioning of the e-collar, but that's not to say we haven't put a bark collar on a dog that's never had a remote collar on before. Right? All right. What else? No, we're not at Walmart. We're actually at a rest stop.
Is playing tug okay if the dog growls?
All depends on the dog. So when girl plays tug, we use one tug toy. I've got some videos on that. And I have no problem with the dog growling because it's probably part of the excitement. So I don't mind if they're going rawr, 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 as long as they out when I tell them to out. Okay, girl. All right, great. The worst bite I've ever gotten is from a dog, not from Linda, okay?
Oh, stop. Okay. Have you done a video on hand-shy dogs?
Have I done a video on hand-shy dogs? I don't think I have, but that would be a clicker. You would want to do clicker food counter conditioning protocol. A clicker food counter conditioning protocol on that, all right? And I've got other videos on something similar, and I can always do that. Linda, you want to write that down for videos if you have a chance?
No.
All right. Okay. No, I don't let my dogs on in bed at all. No, I don't let my dogs in bed at all. That I got probably from Ray Allen or Learberg. I think Learberg. The tug I got is from Learberg. Yep, the green tug is from Learberg, I believe. Learberg. Learberg.com. I'm pretty sure that's where I got it from. What's next?
Should I give my puppy the full range of the crate when I'm not home, take out the divider?
No, I would leave the divider in. The puppy only needs the amount of space that it takes to spin around in and then lie down. The smaller the better for a puppy because you're really trying to get that dog crate trained. Okay, what's next?
I've had a 6-year-old chihuahua from the shelter since December. It snaps at my pit bull and growls at me. I was stroking the dog when this happened.
Okay, well, I mean, the dog, if you're stroking the dog, when that happens and the other dogs were walking by, the dog might be resource guarding you. So just be really, really careful. What's your really, really careful about that? Also, it is possible that your dog doesn't like physical touch, or it is possible that your dog's in a little bit of pain and discomfort. Your dog could have been exhausted. Your dog could have been tired. There's a lot of different variables. And also, there's a lot of possible stimuli that are going on around your dog that you might not have noticed. The bottom line is it's most likely it was an unacceptable behavior. at all, but I need a little bit more context into that. But we stop growling in that context. We stop snapping in that context. I've never trained a dog for protection work, and that's not what I do. That's not what. How do you stop a 9-week-old puppy from biting everyone trying to pet him? What I would do is I would stick your finger down the dog's throat like this, and you would just push their tongue down. But also be careful about how people approach your dog. Your dog should learn how to, at 9 weeks old, your dog can learn how to sit and then take petting calmly. Calm petting, all right? Calm petting. What I would do is make sure that the people that are petting your dog are not all excited, all my high-pitched voices. They should be petting the dog when it's sitting down or all four paws are on the floor and they're doing it nice and calmly. All right, okay. No, I've never been afraid of any dog that I've been working with, but I highly respect all the dogs that I'm working with, all the dogs. And I've worked with some really, really, really nasty dogs, right? Okay.
I have a litter of 6-week-old pups. How would I properly socialize them?
6-week-old puppies, to socialize them, right now you wanna wait, you wanna get them to be socialized. I would work on this as I would start doing sound effects. I would get yourself, download a bunch of sound effects from YouTube, every sound effect. So you wanna do gunshots, thunder, lightning, fireworks, all the different street sounds that are out there. I would get doorbells, knocking on doors, and I would play it really at a low level. I would also get your dog used to many different surfaces and stimuli. I would get your dog used to, like, you know, wet grass, dry grass, sand, leaves, snow, if you live in snow, you know, cement, different certain carpeting. But that's what I want you to get your dogs to be exposed to different stimuli. And then I want your dog to learn about water. You can get your dog used to the feeling of water on its paws. Also get your dog used to physical touch, inspecting its ears, opening up its mouth, lifting up its tail, touching all of it, touching its paws gently. You can gently pick the dog up in the air. Also at 6 weeks old, what I would do is at nighttime, what I would do is start 6 week old, wait maybe one more week and start crating them separately. So when you adopt them or out or you sell them, what they're going to be doing is they won't have a problem with separation anxiety. They won't have a problem with separation anxiety. Is hiding toys behind a couch a form of resource guarding? No, it's not. Okay? No, it's not. So I think there's a difference between pack dogs and working dogs. I don't really understand that question. I think dogs are pack animals. So working dogs, I mean, all dogs, most dogs are bred to do something. Dog growls when we clean his paws after coming in from the rain. The dog is objecting, right? The dog is objecting. So that's an objection. The dog is saying, I don't like that. I don't do Schutzen training. I would find a Schutzen trainer that you can trust, and I wouldn't even know how to do that. What I would do is a food counter conditioning protocol, and I will make a video this week of how to do a counter conditioning protocol on something like the paws. Bottom line is the dogs, you will touch the paws and you'll deliver the dog the food, not treats, but daily food. And the only way that dog will eat for the next 2 weeks is the wiping off of the paws. All right, your puppy will get too aggressive when we're playing with him and he'll start trying to bite us. Well, how old is the puppy? That's common. So just remember, if your dog is 14 weeks old and under, your dogs, they nip. They're puppies. That's what they do. But if your dog is tired, it nips you more. Also, if roughhousing is too rough, personally, I wouldn't roughhouse with a puppy. You know, they're dogs. So you have to be really, really careful. You have to be really, really careful about what you train into the dog, or you can have a dog that'll be out of control. And if you are going to play with your dog rough, you want to make sure that it's structured, meaning it's not just all the time. So you want to be super cautious about when you roughhouse, how you start roughhousing, make sure you stop it cold on command. Same protocol for clipping nails, yes, and the counter conditioning food protocol, which I'll do a video on as well. So you want to make sure that your roughhousing is literally an event if you decide to do it, but I would be super, super careful. But that's what you get when you roughhouse a puppy. They're puppies. That's what they do, right?
I got a ton of questions.
Okay, go ahead.
My dog leans on me. Why?
Your dog leans on you. It could be insecurity. It could be the dog is just nervous. It could be the dog is trying to protect you. It could be so many different things. The bottom line is, if you have your dog is aggressive with humans or dogs, don't allow it. If your dog has anxiety, don't allow it. If your dog resource guards you, don't allow it. If it bothers you, don't allow it. Okay. Raw food or kibble, I think both can be fine. You can do fine with a good kibble. You can do fine with good raw food. All right.
Is there any protocol for bringing baby number two home to the dog?
I've got a very, very strict protocol on baby stuff. What I'd like you to do is go to my Catch account, KATCH.me/solid canine training, and go back maybe about in November, and I've got a video on baby proofing. I'm baby proofing. All right.
Don't answer anything.
Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
How do I convince people that remote collars are not shocking my dog?
Well, I don't convince anybody that remote collars are not shocking your dog. Number one, make videos. First of all, you make videos on them and then show your work. And the bottom line is I was actually gonna do a Periscope on this, because now I'm starting to see people talk about how remote collars are electrocuting dogs. And what that is that's an outright blatant lie. It's actually an unethical lie. And it's sort of, it's literally a lie. I mean, that's like saying, martingale collars are electrocuting dogs. I mean, it's actually a lie. They don't shock a dog. And I don't actually get into engagement with people on that stuff. I don't do any online arguing or online fighting. I just keep training dogs and making videos and showing my work. And what's happening is they just will either believe you or not believe you. But I'm not in the convincing business, right? How do I deal with – I don't deal with positive trainers that bash my methods. I don't deal with that stuff. You know, I just keep – training dogs, making videos, showing my work, and I keep, you know, doing more stuff. And I do a lot of social media.
Okay.
All right.
Why do you think that a majority of your followers and clients are women?
I'd like to think it's because I'm a very attractive, sexy man. But the reason why is because I think women can relate to me a lot, because maybe I speak women, or what I am is I definitely am a very loving, kind, caring person. I think women are attracted to that. I also feel that I explain things in a way that is not condescending. I think I don't shame or blame or insult women. I think I, from what I understand, I'm a breath of fresh air when it comes to male dog trainers. I also feel that a lot of men also do like me as well. I do have a fair amount of male clients. The male clients tend to be ones that are actually have got really good character to themselves. My energy, women like my energy a lot. It is absolutely the Lavender Crocs. Mm-hmm. Absolutely the Lavender Crocs. I mean, what I would be able to, what I would say is, for all the women out there, for all the women out there, and there's a lot of women, why do you, and when I, we don't have to use the word attracted, meaning, you know, sexually attracted, but it's like, what attracts you to my Periscopes? What attracts you to my videos? That would be something for my audience to probably answer instead of me. From what I understand, it is the blatant honesty. It is the matter of fact attitude. It is the respect, though, that I also have. I hold nothing back. I think most people appreciate the fact that I'm really, really just, I just get to the point. Transparency. Here we go. All right, what's the next question?
Do you have a kindergarten type video on recall with a 6-foot leash?
I do. I really do. And thank you for all the kind words that everybody's saying to me. Thank you so much. It really means a lot to me. Thank you so much for all your kind words, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm. I do, and there's a video on remote collar training, on recall. It's in my do-it-yourself DIY section of my YouTube channel. You can get to my YouTube channel by going to my website, and my website is Sell a Canine Training. Sell a Canine Training. Okay, right. What else?
My dog has super anxiety. What should I do?
Your dog has super anxiety. What I'd like you to do is this. I've got a video on separation anxiety. She's a very, very fantastic woman, Linda is. I've got a video on separation anxiety. Watch that video, and there's 13 steps on how to prevent and fix it. Watch that video, and also what I'd like you to do is do all that stuff first, 100% of it, and then let me know the progress of that. Let me know the progress of that. There's a lot of things that you're probably doing not on purpose that are probably making it worse. All right? So just remember, a lot of times, a lot of people, you watched it and your dog still has anxiety. So I want you to make sure is sort of audit yourself on that, and make sure that you are following everything. Sometimes people think they're following it, but they're not. That doesn't mean it's not you. But what I'd like you to do is that. Also more structure and do more duration. Do more duration stuff. I'm glad you're trying. Listen, I'm going to reward you for effort as well then, Atticus. I'm going to reward you for effort, because what I'd like you to do is spend more time on duration work. So duration, I'm all for exercise. We always exercise our dogs, but what people are not doing is they're not doing enough duration work, which is long places and long downstays, and they're not doing enough structure, and they're not giving their dog enough space away from them, all right, information them. All right, what else?
My mini schnauzer has bonded to my husband instead of my daughter. What could I do?
I don't know if the mini schnauzer is bonded instead of. I think we probably should take out that word instead, because we can't tell a dog instead. Like, we can't tell a dog you should have bonded to this person. I think the dog bonded to your husband because that's what your dog wanted to do. Right? I mean, that you can't, don't take it personally. You know, don't take, I think you're taking it a little bit personally, which is fine. I mean, it makes, that's just human nature. You know, that's just human nature, is to take it personally. And we need to all your questions, but just keep in mind, Linda's still catching up on questions that we got a little bit early. So I would just try to maybe get, it's my daughter, she adores my hubby. Oh, your hubby. So maybe if your husband, just the connection wasn't there. You know what I mean? You know? That's all. Don't take it personally. And he shouldn't take it personally either. You know, he just shouldn't. All right, what's next? By the way, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I'm a real world dog trainer. I'm based in Providence, Rhode Island. You can go to my website if one of my fans wants to put up my website, solidcaninetraining.com. And also don't forget, on the repeats, you can share this. You can share this and give me hearts on the replays. People might not realize that you can do that on the replays. Also, you can go to RV Dog Trainer. All right.
When holding place before a walk, how long is acceptable?
I mean, holding place before a walk, that's up to you. No, that's up to you. Thank you, Jackie, for putting my stuff up there. And that's up to you. I mean, what it is. The big thing about going for the walk is I want your dog to be calm prior to the walk, meaning I want your dog to be calm at the front door or the threshold, go outside the door, calm there, and then down your driveway, if you've got a driveway, calm there. Thank you, Oren, for putting up my RV dog trainer site. I want your dog to be calm on all of those things as well. And then your walk, like, set the energy of your walk at the beginning. Don't be like, well, 5 minutes into it, the walk gets better. I realize that. I mean, but I like the walk to be better, like, before the walk. So let's do that. All right.
Dog approaches cats and they sometimes scratch her face off. Why doesn't she learn what to do?
So, what obviously your dog doesn't mind the scratching of the face off, but what I would do is this. If our cat, so our cat Boots and Girl, and back when we had Uma alive, and those were the two of our 9 dogs that were in the house, you know, to go up to my office. And there was a mutual understanding of just like space. And if Girl or Uma, who's passed recently, would chase them, I would correct those two dogs. And if I had a cat that was scratching my dog's face and my dog wasn't doing anything, I probably would bonk the cat. And bonking of the cat is you would just take a towel, wrap it up, put an elastic on it, and you would just throw it at the cat. I mean, I don't want my dog's eyes to be, you know, to be scratched, their nose to be scratched. You know, I don't want that. All right. How long should I expect my shepherd to put up with me wanting to brush him? Till you're done. Till you're done, Vanessa. Till you're done. Okay? Till you're done. All right? Yeah, Uma was great. I know. Thank you all. Thank you all. Girl, here. Plots. Plots. Good. Nene. Good. All right? What else do we got?
1.5-year-old Aussie likes to control fetch, so I have to attach a long lead.
Okay, so if you've got an Aussie that likes to control fetch, I'm not quite sure what that means. Control it. What I would do is I would make sure.
I don't know what this goes with.
I do.
Okay.
Yeah, I do. David, we're going to get to you on that, David. David D. Miller, I think it's David Miller. I think that's who it is, one of my fans. Thank you, David. I think what I would do is if fetch is not going the way you want it to go, I would like train the dog to you set the rules. So I would have it so you're setting the rules to fetch. So what you might want to do is do shorter training periods and then break it down into simpler steps. Work on each step at a time. Fetch actually is a multitask event. So what I would do is if there's a part of fetch that is not going well, I would focus on that particular part to make it better. As far as Dean Miller, during the walk, he's calm, but sometimes slips out around certain dogs. Seems like excitement. Goddess of Yoga, let me just answer that. What do you do in walking any dog that pulls? That's an easy one. Go to my website, and what I would recommend is right away put a prong collar on the dog. I've got a video on how to pick out a prong collar, how to size a prong collar, how to put the prong collar on, how to introduce the dog to a prong collar, and how to start the prong collar on the walk. That's what I would do. All right, but if you're not using the right equipment, it's going to be challenging and frustrating. That's why I'm such a I'm such an advocate of the proper tools, techniques, and philosophy, because I just want to make your life better. I just want to make your life better. All right.
Lab puppy, 13 weeks, wiggles a lot. How to find proper e-collar working level?
So what I would do is if the dog wiggles a lot, 13 weeks, why don't you wait one more week to introduce the remote collar? But in the meantime, you're welcome, Goddess of Yoga. And Goddess of Yoga, you are brand new, I believe. If you are, put yes. I don't recognize you at all. If you're brand new to my Periscope, put yes. Please put yes. No, I'm sorry, put no or yes. Might as well put yes. Put yes. If you're brand new, put yes. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Welcome, everybody, for being on my Periscope. I do these on Mondays and Wednesdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and I'm in an RV because I do travel the in North America, I travel in the RV. A lot of new people. Yeah. Welcome, welcome. I'm really proud of all of you. I hope you're enjoying yourself. I hope you're enjoying yourself on this. I do 20 hours of Periscope a week. And I also have, I do a lot of on Instagram. I've got over 1,000 videos on YouTube and on Facebook. A lot of information I've got on Facebook as well. And I travel the world doing dog training seminars. I'm actually heading down to Florida. I just left Virginia. And I'll be in Florida doing two different seminars. I'll be doing one in New Orleans as well. I'll be out in Australia very, very soon. Yep. Yep. Yeah, this is a really great community we're really building here. I don't put up with any nonsense or disrespect to myself, to Linda, or to any of you. I don't allow any disrespect to any of you at all. So I really feel comfortable with this with this group that we're really, really creating. But I didn't finish on David Miller's thing. What's happening is your dog is like, I forgot what you said, like out of control or getting excited or exploding. There's different stimuli. So thank you, Atticus Milo. There's different stimuli that your dog is obviously being excited about. So what I would do is I would tighten up your heel a little bit better. Also, I would encourage you to do a remote collar heel. Remote collar heel and then remote collar focus. What you're going to do is you're going to get that dog a little bit more focused on you, and now it's focused on all the distractions. Then when you start seeing the so no wrinkles, right? So no wrinkles, don't tell me to not heal. But that wrinkles, that's what you want to address, D. Miller. Address that. And also, I didn't finish up on the 13-week-old puppy. 13-week-old puppy, what I want you to do is this. I've got a wonderful video. I just signed up for Josh. I know, I just saw the advertise today. And I'm going to be down right in that area. I love Josh, he's great. I love him, and I want to go, I bought an audit ticket. I want to go there. I want to go hang out. Yeah, I can't wait either. I'm excited. I'm excited. It should be fun. Yeah, Josh is a great guy. I can't wait. I can't wait. I'm really proud that he's doing seminars. You know, he's a great guy. People don't know Josh Moran from Canine Connection in Buffalo is doing a seminar down in Bradenton, Florida, Jillian's place of business. So anyway, so 13-week-old puppy, I've got a video on there that is called Recall, Sit, Break. Recall, Sit, Break. Recall, Sit, Break.
We answered that question about the tug already.
Yep. So what I want you to do is, you have Gulf Coast Canine. Yep, exactly. Thank you. So what I want you to do is work on focus work. Work on focus work prior. So sit, focus prior to introducing the remote collar, because it'll make it a lot easier for you. It'll make it so much easier for you to do. All right. So, all right, yep. What else do we got? Oh, would love me to come to the Midwest. If you can do this, so in order for me to do a seminar, in order for me to do an RV dog trainer seminar, what I want people to do understand is I need a training center. I'm actually going to talk about that later. I'm actually going to do a Periscope. One of the Periscopes I'm going to do later tonight is a Periscope on the recap of the RV dog training seminar, how people can host them, and what goes on. What goes on? All right. What goes on? So, Chef, growling during tug is okay. It's okay. All right. Yep.
11-week pup, rough houses with older dogs. When is a good time to stop this?
I'd like to think that the older dogs would correct the puppy. I'd like to think that. That was one of the great Uma's great traits. She was a great puppy raiser. If it gets okay. If your 11-week-old dog is roughhousing with the other dogs, the other dogs are trying to get away and avoid, but the puppy keeps going after them, you correct the puppy. If the older dogs roughhouse back, so if it's a mutual give and take relationship, you can leave it alone. But I only want that done outside, and I want it to stop when you, the human, says stop. All right? That's really, really important. I'm not against roughhousing at all. I actually let my dogs roughhouse intensely with each other way more than I would ever let them do with another dog. I let my dogs play fight all the time, but when I say enough, it's over. Literally just like that. Literally like that. Yep. And then I'm a big on-off switch guy. I'm a big on-off switch guy. Don't forget, on the replays, you can share this. You can swipe on your iOS and go up and down on your Android to share this. Also, what you can do is you can give me hearts on the replay. Some people might not know that. The way you give me hearts is you can click. Also, what a lot of people have been telling me they've been doing is they've been logging off and logging back on, because you can only give me 500 hearts at a time. So after 500 hearts, I all your hearts disappear off my Periscope. What are you going to do? You know, what are you going to do? Okay. What else? My male sniffs so much, out of control sniffing. How can I fix that? Maybe get your dog into scent work. But like, okay.
Can you make that go down?
Yeah. What I would do is, it depends what your dog is sniffing. If it's just sniffing the ground when it's outside, maybe there's probably a lot of different things out there. On the walks, I don't allow sniffing. If it's sniffing around your house, that's annoying. Maybe get your dog into scent work. Get your dog into tracking. Maybe try that. Your German Shepherd is a new dog. Thanks to training, he still grumbles when people enter for classes. No aggression. So sniffing outside. Okay, the sniffing outside, is it on leash or off leash when during a walk? If it's during a walk, I would stop that immediately. If it's just free time in the backyard, I personally don't care. Okay? I personally don't care. Why do dogs sniff your crotch? I don't like when dogs sniff my crotch. Why do they sniff someone's crotch? It's a very odorous place. Okay? I do want 500 hearts per person. But 500 hearts goes really, really quick. Absolutely get 500 hearts. Absolutely. What people are doing is some people are telling me, I gave 5,000 hearts, but all those hearts but 500 go away. They all go away. So I only get 500. Absolutely. So, all right. So the crotch is a very odorous place. Armpits are odorous. The crotch is odorous. So that's it. You know, your butt is odorous. So that's just where there's a lot of odor, and dogs use their nose. They use their nose a lot. All right. So Jordan, your German Shepherd is a new dog. Thanks to training, he still grumbles when people enter there for for classes. What I would do, I would stop the growling. All the hurts are is probably just an ego thing, for me. But also, believe it or not, Periscope, they used to use the hearts as more of like a rating. But actually, if they're starting to see a lot of interaction between, good amount of hearts as well as engagement with fans, I believe what they're doing is they can actually start promoting your Periscopes. And since we give out so much great free content, it's important that more and more people find out about our stuff. It's not a growl, it's not barking. You might want to leave it alone. Jordan, leave it alone, see what happens. Leave it alone. This is the great thing about dog training is you can make mistakes. Don't be afraid to make a mistake either. Don't be afraid to make a mistake. Correcting on an e-collar all depends for obedience. We don't correct on e-collars for obedience until the dog understands what is expected of them. For behavior modification, we can correct earlier, such as getting into the cat box, for jumping up on counters, for fence fighting, we would correct earlier. But for obedience, we normally don't correct until we've gone through the proofing and the distraction stage. All right. If you're just tuning in, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. If you go to my website, solidcaninetraining.com. Also go to rvdogtrainer.com.
Dog is afraid of crate. Would duration work help here?
If your dog is afraid of crate, what I want you to do, what I want you to do with the crate is let's turn the crate into a really awesome place. What I would do is I would do kennel up and down. Kennel up and down, and also leave the door open, and then leave the door open to the kennel. Not when you're not there, but when you're there. So teach it for an obedience command. You could also put its daily food in there. You can just put its daily food in there if you want to. So the only way the dog eats is they go in there, right? Is it going there? Okay, girl, that's enough. Girl, hold on, please. Hold on. The chihuahuas are bothering the girl. Hold on.
Don't blame them. Look, they're perfect.
Good. All right. Here we go. Good. This is what we got here.
Don't be insulting my chihuahuas. Oh, thank you.
All right.
Okay, Jeff, do you have a video on starting the treadmill?
Yes, I do, actually. I've got a couple of videos on starting the treadmill. I've got videos on both on YouTube. I've got videos on YouTube, and I've got videos on my Facebook page. But yep, I've got videos. Yep, I have videos on that. All right.
Jerry, they are sweet.
Yep.
Have you ever trained dogs to do agility or pool jumping sports?
I never have. We use agility equipment for just fun. So I've trained dogs on how to do the tunnel, the dog walk, the A-frame, and the table. That's it. I don't know how to do weave pulls. And I don't know any of the official rules. We do it for fun. As far as jumping sports, no. What I do is I do teach dogs how to swim. I've got a video on an in-ground pool and above ground pool, how to teach dogs to swim. I teach every single dog the same way. I don't get into the pool. Every dog has learned, and I've trained, probably over 500 dogs minimum, how to swim. I've done it the exact same way every single time, and it has worked every single time, and it only takes 15 minutes or less every single time. Training collar recall, at what point do you start giving the command without any stimulation? When the dog is doing it. Don't rush. Don't be in a rush at all. All right? When the dog is doing it all the time, then you can do variable. You can mix it up. Sometimes give the remote collar stim, sometimes don't. Was that it? Hold on. Did I get that backwards? Hold on. Oh yeah, no, I got it right. Without any stimulus, you have to wait until you're at the, what we do is when the dog goes to correction mode, when the dog goes to correction mode, what you do is then you can start using it without it. So we, once the dog goes, understands the command, and they're recalling 100% of the time, stop using the recall, and then you go to correction mode, but you go back to putting a long line on the dog. Bathing the dog a couple of times a week is fine.
Hey, don't dogs naturally know how to swim?
No, they do not. What dogs know how to do is they know how to do this, but they don't know how to use their back legs. So what they do is they panic and they go around in circles. So dogs don't go, and when you only use your front paws, you're like this. Your body's like this and you spin around and you're panicky. You're panicky. The dog needs to go like this. The way you'd go like this is the dog has to use its back legs. So if you watch the videos, you'll see, because you'll see some dogs, we show the dog struggling at the very beginning. We show the dog struggling at the beginning so people get an understanding of it. But when there's all that splashing, the dog is not properly swimming. So a dog that properly swims is swimming through water. There's no splashing at all. It's very stealth-like. It's very stealth-like. Yep. So no, they don't. No, they don't. Yep.
What's a good way to correct a 9-week puppy?
A good way. What's the dog doing at 9 weeks? All depends on what the dog is doing. So if it's chewing things, what I do is you can take its mouth and its gums and then turn them into each other. If it's nipping at you, you can stick your thumb into its mouth and push down on its tongue, which the dog doesn't like. I'm not against a little ear pinch. I'm not against a little scruff pinch. I'm not against, for whining, for young puppies, if a dog is whining, I've used a pet convincer before. Sometimes I'll open up their little kennel, I'll just take a little finger and I'll just give them a little tiny poke, you know, boom. And I never, remember, when anybody's ever correcting a dog, no matter for anything, you're never mad or angry. Never be mad or angry when you correct a dog. You should always be calm. All your corrections should come from a state of calmness, no matter what. That's the magic of one of the tricks of balance training, is when we correct dogs, whether we're using aversive or doing some sort of compulsion or pressure, it's never out of anger. It's just matter of fact. You can't do that. That's it. It's simple. You can't do that. Okay, what's next? Client has two puppies from the same litter showing litter mate syndrome. Would you recommend rehoming? I'm not a big, there was just a great article or something. I just saw something about that. I'm not a big fan of two puppies from the same litter. Number one, I think it's gonna be really difficult, but I'm actually not a big fan of two dogs of the same age as puppies from different litters. So imagine you got a puppy at 8 weeks old, and then when the dog was, say, 14 weeks old or 15 weeks old, you got another puppy. And I'm not a big fan of that. I think it's hard enough. Deb Watson from Redmark Kennels posted an article on Facebook. So look up Redmark Training or Redmark Kennels, and she'll have something on Facebook. I'm not a big fan of somebody. I think it's hard enough to train one dog, one puppy. Two things would be really hard. Wendy, if you're waking up in the morning and you're seeing destruction, you're mad. But where's the destruction, Wendy? If you're seeing it in the house, that means you didn't crate the dog. If you see it in the crate, that means the dog loses its bed. So we're gonna have to give you 100% responsibility on that one, Wendy. If your dogs are destroying the house, they should be crated at night. Right, Wendy? Right? Come on. Redmark, one word. Redmark is one word. I know it's on you, I know, good. 100% responsibility, Wendy. Good job. All right, good. What else do we got?
When you say stop the growling, how do I stop the growling with a bonker?
You could, if the dog's like in a crate, you can throw a bonker at the dog. A bonker is just a rolled up towel. It's just a cotton towel, you know, or it could be a cotton poly blend, you know. You just toss it, you say no, or you say quiet. I would say no, and you throw it at the dog. Some sort of interrupter. You can use a pet convincer. All pet convincer is air. It's like a little air canister. It's similar to what you clean your keyboard off of, but it doesn't have chemicals in it. It's sort of like a modified bicycle pump, you know, with a CO2 cartridge in it, and they use something similar to like a paintball cartridge. but you can do that.
Okay. Would you use short or long prongs for German Shepherds using the e-collar? I am not getting any reaction from dogs
so,
that seem to be responding.
Okay, so for a German Shepherd, I would use the longer prongs, the longer contact points, I mean. And then also, you might have to even go to the thick fur ones. Also, get proper fit. It should be super, super snug on the dog. You want to then change sides every 4 to 6 hours. It should be super snug on the dog. You want to make sure that you've got a really good fit to your collar. Okay? You want to make sure you do that. All right.
Worked on the kennel up command for 2 days. What do I do next?
You're done, you mean? So what I would do is you do kennel up and then make sure the dog coming out of the kennel also waits. You can also start doing place command. You can also start doing, you know, waiting for food, which is one of the first things you should be doing. You can start working on sit, down. You can start working on, I mean, it's endless, you know, it's endless.
My dominant female gets asked for muzzle grab by, I don't understand this.
I don't understand what that is. Your dog asks for muzzle grabs by submissive dogs? What, I don't understand that question. What's a muzzle grab? What's a muzzle grab?
Maybe it's a typo.
Oh, he busts out of his kennel. So what I want you to do is, a dog busting out of its kennel. What I want you to do is, you mean he breaks out of the kennel when you're not there? So what I want you to do is this. You have to make sure you secure your kennel, use a heavier duty kennel. You might have to use zip ties on all the weak spots. You might have to put carabiners where the door opens up. Also, what I would do is we remote collar train all the dogs. So what you can do is the first sign, you'd set up a little camera or you would be looking in another room, or looking through a window. And as soon as that dog starts trying to get out of the kennel, you would actually correct it. It will not make your dog afraid of the kennel. What it will do is it's a consequence. Dogs are really smart. Try to bust out of the kennel, consequence. Bust out of the kennel, consequence. And then what happens is your dog understands not to do that. Also start teaching with an e-collar. You would use an e-collar for that. Yep, you'd use an e-collar. Also what you can do is teach the dog how to down in the kennel. Just so they start treating the kennel like more of an obedience command. But you don't tell your dog to down and then like go to work, because if a dog gets up, you've just devalued it. What if your puppy is terrified of the kennel? So we get a lot of dogs that don't like the kennel. So what I would do is this. Your dog has to be kenneled. So let's just make it the best we can for now. I think I would take all emotion out of kenneling the dog. Just a girl. So if you're not familiar with e-collars, what I suggest you do is you watch some of my videos. Number one, they don't shock dogs. It's impossible to shock a dog. All right. The remote training devices, some of them make sound, but we don't use sound. Some of them make vibration. We don't use vibration. We use static, which is not electricity, and there's no shocking at all. It's the same technology as the TENS unit. And what you can do is, I've got so many videos on it you can watch. So if you're not familiar on them, a lot of people think it's something really, really negative. It's actually not a negative thing, okay? It's not a negative thing at all, all right? So I'm glad you're on my scope, and I'm glad that you actually asked and you're being respectful, because that's why it really isn't. They're actually one of the lesser invasive training tools out there. You know, flat buckle collars actually cause more discomfort. And how do I know this? Because I've trained lots and lots of dogs, and I use all different tools. Okay. And it's a great way to communicate with your dog by whispering or shouting up to a mile away. It's a really great way to train. And I've got so many videos on that. So the other scopes I'll be doing tonight is I'm going to do a scope on what does it mean to advocate for your dog? What does it mean to advocate for your dog? And also, I'm going to do a recap on RV Dog Trainer, how you can host one and how to sign up for them, and do a recap of what happened at this weekend's RV Dog Trainer. So I'm going to do two more Periscopes tonight, actually. And thank you for reminding me, Terry. I really appreciate that.
I have a beagle that is 6 months old and really crazy, especially with kids.
Okay. So, you know, the thing about this is, let's get a handle on that beagle now, because it's not going to get any better. And it doesn't make a difference that it's a beagle. It's just a dog. but it's 6 months old, and it's typical that they're out of control in a lot of, you know, families. In my world, we want to make sure that it's, you know, the dog is, your dog is capable of being fully off-leash trained. That's what the cool part is. So what I want you to first start doing is, I want you to go to my YouTube channel, and I want you to start teaching that dog all the basics, how to properly walk on a leash, how to do a place command, how to do a down, how to sit properly, and I want you to also do recall training. I want you to work on the kennel up command and being quiet in the kennel. I want you to teach that dog how to wait at all thresholds and not rush through thresholds at all. Go into its kennel and not rush out of a kennel. I want that dog to understand that what yes is. I want that dog to understand what no is. I also want to make sure that understand that dog does some duration work, which is long down stays in wrong place. I want to make sure that you've got a lot of structure in your home, but also make sure the children are educated on how proper behavior around the dog is, and also when it's time to leave the dog alone. Because what I don't want to see is I don't want to see your dog bite any of your kids, but I also don't want to see your dog jump up on any of the kids either. All right, I'm a big advocate for good behavior with dogs. And I just, the good thing is your dog is capable of doing it. I know it is, because if you follow all my videos and you watch enough of my Periscopes, no, she doesn't. So, Wendy, what I would want you to do is, Linda, just type in your name right there. Type in. What I want you to do is follow Linda. So follow Linda. And when you follow Linda, what you're going to be able to do is just...
What am I doing?
You're just putting any comment up so people can follow you. Yeah. So she's going to put in hi right now. And when she puts in hi, click on her and then follow her. And then what you'll be able to do is, she just put her name up right now. What you'll be able to do is, you'll be able to, now you have W Big Lashes, click on that, and then she does her own Periscopes. Yep, she does her own Periscopes. So no, she goes to a salon. She goes to a salon for that.
I do. Right,
so yep, awesome. So people are following her. Awesome, that's great.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Nicole and Vegan Future. Thank you so much. All right, so let's see, what else do we have?
Oh, my trainer says that it's hard to teach a dog to do down from a distance. I know girl does it. How do you do it?
So what I'd like you to do is this. Down from a distance, make sure your dog understands how to do it down close by with a remote collar. And then it doesn't have to be a remote collar, but they do it close by. Then what you do is you put your dog on a tie out. A tie out is you would tie your dog to like a heavy piece of furniture with enough leash to come off of, to move around. And then what I want you to do is, from 2 feet away, have the dog do it down, and the dog can't come towards you. It has to stay where it is. 3 feet away, 4 feet away, 5 feet away, 6 feet away, until the dog understands the concept of down. And we do it with remote collar because that's how we train the dog. So the fact that the dog's on a tie out, it can't come to you. So it can't, you know, so it can't run to you. All right, it can't run to you. All right, what do we got?
Dog chases cat, intent to harm. Use e-collar placed with corrections for chasing the dog.
What I would do is correct the dog pretty hard, high, for chasing the cat, because your cat could die. And I don't want your dog to kill your cat. So what we would do is we would put that dog into avoidance, meaning chasing cats suck. And then what we would do is make sure the dog understands place, put the dog on a tie out in place so it can't chase the cat. It can break command, but it can't chase the cat. And then I would get that dog to get used to existing with the cat. That's what I would do. Okay. Right, we're coming up to the end of the show. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. My website. Right there. And then I'm not a big fan of Pet Finder, but if it's working for you, go ahead. I'm just not a big fan of Pet Finder because it doesn't have enough settings, enough numbers. The ones we use have 100 different levels. And with the kind of training we do, we really like to get the right exact level. Okay. I like a little bit more flexibility in my remote collars. But if it's working for you, you know, go ahead and use it. If it's working for you. Sport Dog does make some good ones. I'm not against Sport Dog at all because some of them have up to 18 levels. You know, some of them have up to 18 levels. Yeah. All right. You're welcome. right? So we're going to end the show right now. Let's give us one more last round of hearts. One more last round of hearts. And I'm going to take a little bit of a break. And I think we got to put Angelo to bed. Okay, we're going to read him a book. Oh, we have to read the rest of the book. We have to read.
He doesn't want to read.
Oh, he doesn't want to read tonight?
He doesn't want to read that book, he said. Remember? Oh. Maybe he'll change his
Angelo, mind. Do you want to read a book tonight? Okay. The same book as last night. Do you want to finish it or do you want to do a new one? He wants to finish it.
Oh, good.
So we're going to read, we're going to finish the book that Angelo and I started last night. And we're going to probably do that in about 10 minutes. Okay, thank you. First of all, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. You go to, can you put the websites in? SolidCanineTraining.com. You can go to SolidCanineTraining.com. And also you can go to RVDogTrainer.com. RVDogTrainer.com. And you'll learn a lot about me. And I'm an active dog trainer. I train dogs for a living.
It's RV Dog Trainer, right?
Right, yep. RVDogTrainer.com. And you can also hit the little character in the corner. You can share this on Facebook, share this on Twitter. And also what you can do is you can, I'm on Instagram. I'm on Snapchat. I'm on YouTube. I'm on obviously Periscope, which is what we're on right here. I've got my website. And what else? What other social media am I doing?
You didn't say Facebook, did you?
And I'm on Facebook in a huge, huge, huge way. I put up a really cool video of Girl and I today. And I'll be putting up more photos and videos tonight. And obviously every day I put up anywhere from 6 to 7 posts. All right. Snapchat, I'm still trying to figure out, but I'll be doing it. And if, who wants to do a screenshot? Best dog food brands. I do Volhard Raw, but Fromm makes a good one. Canada makes a good one. Go to dogfoodadvisor.com. Dogfoodadvisor.com. That's what I would do. So if you do a screenshot right now, the way you do a screenshot is you just screenshot your screen, and then if you tweet it to me, so go if you do @SolidCanineTraining, attach the picture, and if you write I love Jeff and Linda. I love Jeff and Linda. What I'll do is I'll send you back a video. I'll send you back actually a personalized video, you know, just for you. And I spend a lot of time going really deep with my fans because I think it's really, really important. So let's do screenshots and we'll hold this for 10 seconds. The way you make a screenshot is you hit your on-off button and your function button, right? Is that what that is? To do a screenshot. So to do a screenshot, I would hit this button and this button. So same time. Oops, nope. I did it wrong. That was a screenshot. Okay. So you hit the side button before you hit the bottom button. All right. All right. So we're going to head out and let me just do one last shot of the dogs.
Here comes your dog.
Come on, girl. Don't. Should we say out? Come on. Real place. So here's some of the kids. Romy, Clover. Hey, Angelo. Say hi. Was he sleep? Are you sleeping, buddy? He's sleeping already, mama.
Aww.
Just the chihuahuas. It's Fabienne. Kaiser. Girl. These are a little setup, by the way.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you all so much, and I really, really appreciate everybody participating tonight in such a big way, and we'll see everybody in a little bit. I'm going to be doing, you know, a couple more Periscopes tonight. All right. We really love you guys, and we really, I might have to read to the dogs. I know. I think Angelo's sleeping. He's up there. He's all covered up underneath the
I might leave him there.
Thing. Yeah, might leave him there. All right. All right. Take care. Take care, everybody. I really, really appreciate it. I feel really honored and blessed that I can teach. And I'm a student as well, and I'm always learning. So it's always great to be able to share information with everybody.
Sweet dreams, everyone.
Okay, take care. Bye-bye. I'll just turn off Google Hangouts.